So in the last class, we have discussed about the small signal model of BJT amplifier, and more specifically, we have discussed two different models. One was pi model, and the second one was the hybrid model or each parameter model. And eventually, we have established that this pi model of a transistor and the each parameter model of transistor can be thought to be equivalent. And we have got a structure like this for the BJT amplifier. We have considered it to be a black box, a two-port network kind of thing. And this port is known to be the input port. And whenever we are using the amplifier in the common emitter configuration, then base to emitter terminal is considered to be the input terminal, and the collector to emitter terminal is considered to be the output terminal. So considering that the amplifier is a kind of common emitter configuration, so this is your B terminal, base to emitter configuration, base to emitter terminal, and we have collector to emitter terminal. So emitter is common to both the input and output. And eventually, we have drawn or we have established the relationship between these two models. And for each parameter model, we have four elements. For pi model, we have three elements. And we have ultimately established a relationship. Now, henceforth, we will be using this pi model. Now, you know, in pi model, we have this input resistance connected between this base to emitter terminal represented by R pi. And we have one current source, voltage dependent current source over here, whose value is like Gm times V pi. And we have this output resistance R naught in shunt with this. We have also established the relationship between this Gm R pi with the beta. For example, we have established that R pi, the input impedance, can be written like Vt, the thermal voltage, divided by the IBQ. What is IBQ? IBQ is the quiescent base current of the transistor. And Gm is the mutual conductance or transconductance, which was equal to ICQ by Vt, where ICQ is nothing but the quiescent collector current of the transistor amplifier. And if you multiply these two, Gm and Rpi, you will find that Gm multiplied with Rpi the expression for current gain, that is ICQ by IBQ. Now we have also calculated the value of R naught, which was equal to VA, the early voltage, divided by ICQ. Normally, this early voltage is quite large, in the order of few hundreds of volts. So as a matter of fact, the value of R naught is very large, in the order of few hundreds of kilo ohms or even larger. Now let me talk about some typical values for R pi and Gm. Now you know that the thermal voltage Vt at room temperature, the thermal voltage Vt is approximately equal to 25 millivolt, close to that. And if I assume that this base current, quiescent base current, normally it is in the order of few microampere. So for the sake of calculation, if I assume it to be 5 microamperes, so in that case, considering these two together, we'll find that R pi is coming like 5 kilo ohms. So normally, the value for R pi is in the order of few kilo ohms, because Vt, the thermal voltage, is in the order of millivolt, and the base current is in the order of quiescent base current is in the order of microampere, so milli by micro. So normally 5 kilo ohms, normally kilo ohms, so maybe 2.5 kilo ohms, 3 kilo ohms, 4 kilo ohms. So it is in the order of few kilo ohms. Now, what about R naught? R naught, you know, VA, as I've already mentioned, it's very large, close to say 100 or 200 volt. With respect to ICQ, for beta to be 100, you know that if IBQ is equal to 5 microampere, and if I assume that beta is equal to 100, so in that case, you find that ICQ is coming like 0.5 of milliampere. 5 micro into 100, so 500 microampere, so that is equal to 0.5 of milliampere. So in this case, if I assume that VA to be, say, 200 volt, if the early voltage is equal to 200 volt, for example, so it signifies that the R naught value is almost equal to 400 kilo ohms. R naught is coming like 400 kilo ohms. So it's typically very large. Typically very large with respect to R pi. So sometimes, since the value of R naught is very large and it is coming in shunt with this voltage dependent current source, so for accurate calculation, you have to incorporate the value of R naught. But for, you know, to get some rough estimation of the value for this voltage gain, you can also ignore the value of R naught, because the value of R naught is very large and it is coming in shunt with this current source. So this is all about the pi model. We have three terminals. We have three elements over here. One is the R pi, that is the input impedance, input resistance. Second one is the GM times V pi, where GM is nothing but the mutual conductance, and V pi, as you know, is nothing but this voltage drop across this resistance R pi, and R naught, which is nothing but output resistance equal to VA by ICQ. So these are the three elements. Now, based on this model of transistor, we would be interesting to calculate the voltage gain of a different amplifier model. So to start with, we'll be discussing about the common emitter configuration, and gradually we'll be discussing the other modes as well. For example, we'll be discussing like common base configuration, the common collector configuration, and some cascade configuration as well. So to start with, let us consider the first model of transistor amplifier, that is the common emitter, and here I'm assuming the simplistic model. So let me start with some simplistic model over here. So you have the collector resistance RC, which acts like the load resistance. Now base is getting the drive from this resistance RB. Now there is a supply, and apart from that, there is a signal source. So this is the signal source VS, and this is a supply to bias this base emitter junction VBB. You have RC over here, that is the collector resistance or output resistance you may think of, and this is nothing but your collector supply, that is VCC. So very simplistic model over here I have considered, consisting of only two resistances, RC and RB. RC is known to be the collector resistance, and RB is known to be the base resistance, which is used to drive this base emitter junction. And emitter is grounded, so this terminal is directly connected to ground, and VS is the supply voltage which we want to, this is a signal source which you want to amplify over here, and we are getting this output across this terminal. So this is a V naught terminal. Now we are interested in finding out the voltage gain for this particular common emitter amplifier. So to start with, initially you have to find out the DC operating point, and perhaps you know how to calculate the DC operating point. So since this is a kind of a linear amplifier, so DC analysis and AC analysis can be performed separately, and in order to obtain the final output, we can add on the individual outputs. So for DC analysis, this AC signal source, this signal source VS, this is absent, and we have over here this VBB, the base supply, and accordingly you can write down the expression for this Kirchhoff's voltage law along this base emitter junction. It's very easy to write, and you can easily get the expression for IBQ. So I can write VBB is equal to IBQ times RB plus VB on. So VB on is nothing but the on voltage, typically 0.7 volt. And if you know VB and if you know VB on, you can easily calculate the value of IBQ for a given RB. Similarly, you can also find out the value for VC. Given the value of IB, you can calculate what is the value of IC or ICQ by multiplying IBQ with beta. And writing down the expression for Kirchhoff's voltage law, KVL, across this collector emitter loop, across the output loop, you can write this to be ICQ times RC plus VCE. So given IBQ, having calculated IBQ and putting the value of beta, you can know what is the value of ICQ. And given RC and ICQ and VCC, you can easily calculate VCE. So from this DC analysis, using these two simple equations, you can easily find out what is the quiescent operating point for this particular transistor, that is this pair VCEQ, ICQ, this pair. Now after that, you have to go for the AC analysis. So you know for AC analysis, all the DC sources must be zero. That means all the DC sources must be inactive. Now here we have considered two DC sources. One is the supply VCC. Second one is this one is VBB. So there are two DC sources. Now for AC calculation or for AC analysis, these DC sources must be considered to be inactive. So this is the circuit diagram for this common emitter configuration. Now what will be the corresponding AC equivalent circuit? Now for AC equivalent circuit, we have to make sure that the corresponding DC sources are inactive. Now to start with, we have this RC over here. So this is a resistance, passive element. It should be there over here. You have this transistor. This terminal is connected to ground. Emitter is connected to ground. This is the ground terminal. Okay, fine. Now you have RB over here. Up to this, it is fine. But since we are dealing with this AC analysis, so obviously you must understand that DC source must be inactive. It must be zero. So you have only this supply VS. That means the signal source over here, which you want to amplify. Now over here, initially you have VCC in the main circuit, but in the AC equivalent circuit, this should be inactive. So since it is inactive, so it should be, it's a DC source, DC voltage source, it should be grounded. Because VCC means a constant supply. So it contains no time varying component. So as a matter of fact, in the AC equivalent circuit, the value for this particular, this terminal voltage will be equal to zero because it's held at a constant voltage. So this is grounded. So this is the AC equivalent circuit. This is the AC equivalent circuit for this common emitter amplifier. Now, if you have a current source over here, in any case, then you have to open the two terminals because in order to make the current source inactive, you need to make it open circuited. And in order to make the voltage source inactive, you need to make it short circuited. So since we have two voltage sources over here, we have two voltage sources. One is this one, VBB. Second one is this one, VCC. So we have made these two voltage sources short circuited in order to obtain the AC equivalent circuit. Now having got the AC equivalent circuit, our next job is to find out the AC equivalent model for this particular transistor amplifier. To start with, we need to, we can move to the next slide. Let me draw the AC equivalent circuit once again so that the AC equivalent circuit and the corresponding analysis can be there side by side. You have RB over here and the signal source VS. This is RB. And this is RC, and this terminal is grounded, and we need to find out this voltage, output voltage. So this is the AC equivalent model for this particular amplifier. Now let us move into the corresponding analysis. So to start with, we have to model the amplifier by means of a black box, and we have to populate the elements inside the black box. What is there inside? We need to identify it properly. Now this terminal is the base terminal, as you know, it's a two-port network. We are modeling the transistor as a two-port network. So this is the base terminal. This is the emitter terminal. This is the collector terminal. And this is the emitter terminal. So emitter is common. Now between base to emitter, you have R-pi. You have R-pi between base to emitter. That means we are modeling this transistor. We are modeling this transistor. What is there inside? So it will be R pi. And we have the voltage dependent current source, GM times V pi between collector to emitter. This one, GM times V pi. And apart from that, you have R naught over here. So this particular black box basically models the transistor inside. Now, apart from the transistor, within the amplifier model, we have two additional components as well. So we have the resistance RB over here. We have this resistance RP over here, and we have another resistance RC over here. Now, how to place these two resistances in this particular equivalent model? Now, you know, RB is connected in this particular fashion, that one terminal of RB is connected to the base and the other terminal of RB is connected to the signal source. Whereas for RC, one terminal of RC is connected to the output terminal or the collector terminal, and the other terminal of RC is connected to the ground. Now let us try to populate these elements. So for RB, one terminal is connected to the base terminal. So we have connected one terminal to the base terminal. This is RB. And the other terminal of RB is connected to the signal source. This is grounded. So you have VS over here. Whereas for RC, one terminal is connected to collector and the other terminal is connected to ground. Now, you know, here emitter is already grounded. So I can safely connect this RC resistance between collector to emitter, because emitter is already connected to ground. Or I can connect these two together, and this is connected to ground. So this is the equivalent model for the amplifier itself. So from this, you need to find out the expression for the voltage gain. So what is the expression for voltage gain? We are obtaining output voltage over here. This is V naught, and we are providing the input signal Vs over here. So what is the expression for voltage gain? So the expression for voltage gain AV is nothing but V naught upon Vs. So V naught is the output voltage that we are getting at the collector terminal with respect to emitter. So emitter is grounded here. So the absolute potential at the collector terminal will be the output voltage, and the input signal is the Vs. The small signal voltage that we are getting in the form of Vs. This is amplified by this amplifier, by this transistor amplifier, and we are getting an amplified version or magnified version in V naught. So V naught upon Vs is the ratio for the voltage gain. Now, how to calculate this? Now, to start with, let us first try to identify this voltage. As you know, this voltage is nothing but V pi, the voltage drop across the resistance R pi. Now, you can easily find out the relationship between Vs and V pi using a simple voltage divider law. You know, V pi is given by Vs upon Rb plus R pi multiplied with R pi. So this is the expression for V pi. Now, what about R naught? You have R naught connected over here in shunt with RC. So what will be the effective resistance across or in shunt with GM V pi? We have R naught over here, we have RC over here. So the effective resistance will be R naught parallel RC. Now, what will be the output voltage? Output voltage is nothing but this current GM V pi multiplied with the effective output resistance. Now, as you know, here the current flow direction is just like this. That means we are assuming that as far as the conventional model for a two-port network, that current is entering into the network and that direction is considered to be the positive direction. Now, under this condition, if current enters the network in this way, so obviously this terminal will be at a lower potential with respect to this terminal, because whenever the current is flowing from this terminal to that terminal, from collector to emitter terminal, then only this potential will be higher than this potential. So as a matter of fact, we can write V naught is given by minus GM times V pi into the effective resistance. What is the effective resistance? R naught parallel RC. This is the effective resistance. So V naught is given by this particular expression. Now you can simply substitute the value for V pi over here. So I can take it outside, minus GM R naught parallel RC. Then I can take it outside. Now V pi is represented by R pi upon Rb plus R pi multiplied with Vs. So from this, the expression for voltage gain AV is given by V naught by Vs, that is equal to minus GM R naught parallel RC into R pi by Rb plus Rb. So this is the final expression for the voltage gain. Now if you closely observe this particular expression, you'll see that this voltage gain AV is a strong function of the transistor internal parameter. Now in the expression of AV, you have this GM times R naught parallel RC multiplied with R pi divided by Rb plus R pi. Now, Rb and Rc, these are the external resistances which you have connected explicitly to the amplifier circuit. But what about this GM, R0 and Rpi? This GM, R0 and Rpi are the parameter of the transistor itself. So, in case this particular transistor is replaced by some other transistor for any reason, while these resistances, Rb and Rc, are remaining constant, remaining fixed, if the parameter of this particular transistor is getting modified by some means, in that case, you will see that the voltage gain will be different, because this voltage gain is a strong function of the transistor internal parameter, that means GM, R naught, and R pi. Now I can find out an approximate expression for the voltage gain. So this is the exact equation which we have written so far. An approximate expression for the voltage gain will be something like this. This R pi by Rb plus R pi, normally it is known to be the, in some cases it is known to be the loss, the coupling loss, which are taking place over here. because we have provided the input signal to be Vs, but the signal that is basically coupled to the amplifier is nothing but Vpi. So this Vpi by Vs, that ratio is known to be the coupling loss, and we want that this ratio should be as close to 1 as possible. So Rpi by Rb plus Rpi. So normally, if Rb value is very small, in that case, with respect to Rpi, so you can consider that this particular entire expression is becoming close to 1, Rpi by Rb plus Rpi. But for this particular configuration, Rb cannot be very small. But even still, if we consider that Rb is small with respect to Rpi, so in that case, Rpi by Rb plus Rpi, that ratio is coming close to 1. And R0 parallel RC, that particular ratio, I mean, that particular expression, R0 parallel RC, can be considered to be equivalent to RC itself, because R0 is very, very large with respect to RC. And so two resistances connected in shunt, and if one resistance is very large with respect to the other, then the equivalent resistance can be treated to be equal to the lower resistance. So I can equivalently write this expression to be RC. Safely, I can write this expression to be equal to RC. So even if I do not neglect the coupling loss, that part, but still I can write this is approximately equal to minus GM times RC. And if you wish, you can always incorporate this one, Rb plus Rpi. Even if I neglect this one, if I equate this one, this particular expression equal to 1, so then also the voltage gain is a function of the transistor internal parameter, because it's a function of GM and RC. So RC is the output resistance that you have connected between the collector and this supply. This is the load resistance. But GM, as you know, the expression for GM, I have initially mentioned what is expression for GM. It's represented by ICQ by VT, and it's a strong function of temperature. And if I change the any particular transistor by some other transistors, in that case, GM will be different. And so if I replace this transistor with a different one, having a different value of GM, then the voltage gain will be different. So as a matter of fact, I can say that this particular amplifier model is not that much stable with respect to the fluctuation of the different parameters. And another thing which you must notice over here is that the voltage gain, in the expression for the voltage gain, you have a negative sign over here, a negative sign. What is the significance of negative sign? It means whenever the input signal goes like this, your output will be something like that. So there is a phase reversal. So there will be a phase reversal. It will be a magnified version. If it's like 5 millivolt, it may be like 500 millivolt. So if the gain is 100, so if the input signal excursion is 5 millivolt, so output signal excursion could have been 500 millivolt, but there will be a phase reversal. Because as you know, as this particular signal, this Vs is increasing like this, so it will provide more base drive to this particular transistor amplifier. As a matter of fact, the base current will be increased. Now, if the base current is increased, it will eventually increase the corresponding collector current. And you know the expression, a very popular equation in the output circuit of this particular amplifier, VCC is equal to ICRC plus VCEQ. Or VCC, if I want to write down the the total instantaneous expression, then also this VCC is equal to small I capital C, the total instantaneous current into RC, plus small V capital C. So if input signal Vs increases, it will increase the corresponding IV value. That means the base current, I capital B, I can write. As a matter of fact, IC will also increase. The collector current will also increase. Now, when collector current increases, VCC is constant, so RC is fixed. So if IC increases, VC will drop. So as VS increases, so what is VC? VC is nothing but VO. So VO, magnitude wise, VO will drop. So whenever this is in the positive half cycle, this input signal, so output signal will be in the negative half cycle. So as a matter of fact, there will be a phase reversal of 180 degrees. between the input and the output. And this is the property of the common emitter amplifier. And as you understand that this particular biasing arrangement is not at all suitable for many of the practical applications. So as a matter of fact, people normally think about the voltage divider kind of biasing arrangement for a common emitter configuration. So let me discuss about the voltage divider biasing arrangement and try to draw the corresponding equivalent circuit. As you know, there are two resistances, R1 and R2, in this way. Initially, I'm assuming that this emitter is connected to ground. And you have the collector resistance over here. This is a supply line. This is VCC, RC over here, this is R1, you have R2 over here. Now the signal source is connected at this particular point, which you want to magnify. This is VS. Now it is associated with some small source resistance, RS. And apart from that, we have a coupling capacitor connected between the signal source and the amplifier. The purpose of this coupling capacitor is to isolate the signal source from the amplifier itself. We will discuss the requirement of this coupling capacitor in much more detail whenever we will be discussing the effect of the transistor internal capacitors in the next module of our discussion. Now, so far, let us assume that this coupling capacitor is there so as to prevent any DC current to flow through this signal source whenever the AC signal is absent. So in that case, this coupling capacitor is present. It will prevent any DC current to move into the signal source. So it acts like a DC isolation between the amplifier and the signal source. However, for the signal frequency, whenever the input signal is present, that means whenever this time-varying signal is present, so then this particular coupling capacitor will provide very small impedance in the order of few tens of ohms, like 5 ohms, 10 ohms, or 20 ohms. So that it can be considered to be negligible with respect to the higher value of input resistance for the amplifier itself. So essentially, whenever we'll be discussing about the small signal model of this particular amplifier, so then you'll see that this particular coupling capacitor or the effect of the coupling capacitor can be treated to be negligible, or I can always consider it to be like a short circuit. However, for the DC analysis, this coupling capacitor will provide infinite impedance because, as you know, the reactance provided by the coupling capacitor is given by 1 by twice by FC. So if the frequency of operation is equal to 0, that means for DC signal, this coupling capacitor, any capacitor, will provide an infinite impedance. So it will isolate this amplifier from this particular signal source. So you have a coupling capacitor, I mean, you have a source resistance, RS, over here. And the output is taken from this particular point. So first of all, you need to draw the corresponding AC equivalent model. So for AC equivalent model, so you have R1, these two resistances will be there. So no change with these resistances. RC is there between collector terminal to VCC. Now this terminal is grounded. For AC equivalent circuit, this is grounded because initially in the previous circuit, it is connected to VCC. Now VCC is known to be the supply voltage, a constant DC supply. So for which AC component is zero. So for the AC analysis, this point to be grounded, this terminal to be grounded. That means the AC component or AC contribution from this component, from this particular terminal is zero. So that's why it is grounded for the AC component, for the AC signal. And we have RS over here, the small signal, I mean the signal source resistance. And this is considered to be short circuited, the coupling capacitor. So that's why I can directly connect it to the base terminal. And you have this supply over here, I mean the signal source over here, VS. You have RS over here. This is R1, this is R2. Emitter is grounded. We have RC over here, and we are taking the output from this terminal. So this is nothing but the small signal equivalent model for this particular common emitter amplifier. Now let us draw the equivalent model in terms of the circuit perspective. So once again, we need to start with a black box topology. So this is the base terminal, this emitter terminal, to input port. So this is the base terminal, as you know. This is the emitter terminal. This is the collector terminal, and this is the emitter. So these two emitters are connected together. Now what about the internal component? So it will be just like the previous diagram. You have R pi over here. And you have GM P pi. And if you wish, you can also incorporate this R naught, but since it is pretty large and it is connected in shunt, so for most of the applications, you can also neglect the role of this R naught. If you wish, you can neglect, you can connect it over here. So this is nothing but GM times V pi. And this voltage is nothing but the V pi. So this is all about the internal parameters, which are there inside the transistor, which we cannot observe from outside. Now, what about the other parameters which are already connected, the explicit resistances, R1, R2, RC, and RS, how to connect them? Now, RC, as you know, one terminal of RC is connected to this collector terminal, other terminal is connected to the AC ground. So I can directly connect between the collector to emitter because emitter is grounded. That is fine. Now, what about R1 and R2? Now, if you observe over here, this terminal is a common to both R1 and R2. What about the other terminal? The other terminals are nothing but the ground, AC ground. So R1 and R2, I can visualize that these two resistances, R1 and R2, they are connected in shunt. Although apparently it seems that it is connected in series path, but in the AC equivalent circuit, it is connected in shunt path because two terminals, out of these two terminals, one terminal is connected together. And what about the other terminal? They are also tied up together. So R1 and R2, they are connected in shunt path. One terminal is connected to the base and the other terminal is connected to the AC ground. So I can connect over here R1 parallel R2. Because as you know, this emitter is grounded. I can connect inside or outside. Doesn't make any difference whether you connect inside or outside. Doesn't make any difference. So this is R1 parallel R2. What about the RS and VS? So I can directly connect this like this. This is VS, this is RS. So V0, the output voltage obtained at the collector terminal, and you need to find out the ratio between V0 and VS, which will give you the value for the voltage gain for this voltage divider amplifier circuit, common emitter amplifier circuit. I believe that okay, so we need to draw once again the same diagram so as to analyze the circuit. This is RC, this is R naught, this is GM times V pi, this is R pi. Now you have R1 parallel R2 connected over here. This is R1 parallel R2. And you have a signal source Vs. This is Rs. Now this is R1 parallel R2, this resistance. I think there is some disturbance in the PowerPoint itself. So let me start a fresh one. So let me start with a new presentation. Okay, so now it has come properly. So let me once again draw this one. This is the signal source VS. We have RS connected over here, which is nothing but the source resistance. Now you have two resistances, R1 and R2, connected in shunt. So I can consider these two resistances, R1 parallel R2, whose one terminal is connected to the base and the other terminal is connected to the ground. Now this entire thing is fed into the amplifier itself. So let me draw the black box model of the amplifier. Now inside the amplifier you have three elements. As you know, one element is the RPI, the input impedance. Second element is the voltage dependent current source, that is GM times VPI, and the third element is the output resistance. So let me draw this. So this one is RPI. Now you have GM times VPI over here. This is GM times VPI. This is R0. We have RPI over here. These two are connected. And the output side, we have the collector resistance RC. Needless to mention, this terminal is the collector terminal. This is the emitter terminal. This is the base terminal. And this is also the emitter terminal, which is connected to ground. Emitter is grounded, so you can connect to ground just like this. Now you have to find out the voltage gain. So over here the output voltage is given by V0. The input voltage that we are providing is VS. So V0 by VS is the ratio of the expression for the voltage gain, V0 by VS. So how to find out this voltage gain? So in order to find out the voltage gain, first of all, you need to find out what is the value of V pi. V pi, you know, V pi is nothing but the voltage that is being coupled into the input of the amplifier. The signal that you are feeding from the external signal source is Vs. But remember, because of the this resistance Rs and R1 and R2 and R pi, you must expect that not the entire voltage Vs is being coupled to the input side. So Vs and V pi, they are not equal to same, but there is a change. So V pi is little bit less with respect to Vs, which is known to be the coupling loss. And V pi is provided to the input of the amplifier. And once again, this V pi is magnified and we are getting the output like V naught. So we need to find out what is the relationship between Vs and V pi first of all. Because in the output side, the expression is almost a similar one. So I can write the output side first. The expression is quite the similar one. V naught, I can write like this, minus Gm times V pi multiplied with R naught parallel RC. So as we have written previously, this is the expression for V naught, minus Gm times V pi R naught parallel RC. But this time, V pi and Vs, they are not related linearly. However, there is a few resistances which must be taken into account. So looking at this terminal, so if I look from this terminal itself, if the resistance looking from this terminal is to be R in, then what is the value of R in? You know, here you have two resistances. One is R1 parallel R2, second one is R pi. These two resistances are connected in shunt path. So as a matter of fact, the value of R in looking from this terminal is nothing but, so I can easily write R in is nothing but R1 parallel R2 parallel R pi. So now the input side of the amplifier will be simplified to this one. You have Vs over here. You have Rs, the signal source resistance Rs, and the signal source observes a resistance Rin because of the presence of the transistor, and the biasing resistance is R1 and R2. So this entire thing is reflected, is embedded in the form of Rin. This is grounded, this is grounded. And the voltage that is being developed over here is nothing but the V pi. So since R1, R2, and V pi, R pi, all of them are connected in shunt, so you must understand that the voltage developed across this Rin is nothing but V pi. So what is V pi then? So V pi, I can write by V pi is equal to Vs divided by Rs plus Rin multiplied with Rin. So if I put the value for Rin, so this is coming like Vs divided by Rs plus R1 parallel R2 parallel R pi multiplied with R1 parallel R2 parallel R pi. So this is all about the expression for V pi. So now you have the value for V pi in the form of Vs. So I can substitute V naught in the expression of minus Gm. You have R naught parallel RC, and V pi I can write like this, Vs divided by Rs plus R1 parallel R2 parallel R pi multiplied with R1 parallel R2 parallel R pi. So V naught by Vs, expression for the voltage gain AV, is coming like minus Gm times R naught parallel RC, and then you have this expression R1 parallel R2 parallel R pi divided by Rs plus R1 parallel R2 parallel R5. As you know, the value for these resistances R1 and R2, they are in the order of few kilo ohms, tens of kilo ohms, and R5 is also in the order of 4 to 5 kilo ohms. So each of these resistances R1, R2, and R5, they are in the order of kilo ohms. However, the resistance Rs is in the order of few ohms or tens of ohms. So as a matter of fact, since Rs is in few tens of ohms, and whereas R1, R2, R5, they are in the order of few kilo ohms, so obviously this Rs is much, much less as compared to this R1 parallel R2 parallel R5. So if I just observe this particular ratio, the numerator and denominator, they are very much close to each other, because I mean just neglect Rs with respect to this R1 parallel R2 and parallel R5. So this entire expression, in this entire ratio can be considered to be equal to unity. So hence, we will find that the voltage gain is coming like minus Gm times R0 parallel RC. So a similar kind of expression, which we have seen last time, minus Gm times R0 parallel RC. And if you have this R0, if you assume that R0 is much, much larger with respect to RC, so in that case, you may just neglect the value of R0 over here, and because it is in the shunt path, so you can approximate this one. You can approximate this one, this expression, the expression for voltage gain, if it can be approximated to minus Gm times RC. But you know that this particular circuit diagram, this voltage divider bias is much more stable with respect to the corresponding fluctuation, which might take place for a fixed bias circuit or base bias circuit, as we have mentioned previously. Now, for this voltage divider biasing circuit, so far we have assumed that there is no emitter resistance connected together. So we have assumed that the emitter terminal is connected directly to the ground. But what if the emitter is not directly connected to ground? Rather, if the emitter terminal is connected to ground through some resistance, then what happens? So for this particular amplifier circuit, let us first draw the amplifier circuit first and then find out the equivalent model, and gradually we will be developing the expression for the voltage gain. So now, so far we have assumed that, or we have seen that this emitter terminal is directly connected to ground, but now let us connect on emitter resistance through which this emitter is grounded. This is to increase the stability of the circuit. So here we have RC. The supply voltage is connected over here. R1, R2. I may also show this coupling capacitor. And you have a signal source Vs over here, coupling capacitor CC to complete the circuit, and we have RS, the signal source. So now we would be interested in developing the corresponding small signal model for this amplifier, common emitter amplifier, for which the emitter is not connected to grounded. Rather, emitter is connected to ground through a resistance RE. So obviously for this, the small signal model will be a little bit different. So first of all, let us populate the amplifier itself. I mean, this three components inside this black box. Sometimes you can also think that since R0 is much, much larger with respect to the output resistance RC or collector resistance RC, so to simplify things, you can also neglect this R0. So only you have Gm times V pi. You have R pi over here. And this voltage drop is nothing but V pi. This is the voltage V pi. Now it is time to connect the other terminals, I mean the other elements which are there. Now, as you know, you have R1 and R2. So these two resistances are, once again, they are connected to this base terminal. One terminal of these two resistances are connected to base of the transistor, and the other terminals are connected to ground. So last time we have connected this R1 parallel R2, R1 shunt R2, this resistance combination in shunt with R5, because that time this emitter terminal was connected to ground directly. But this time, this is your base terminal. This is your collector terminal. This terminal is the collector terminal. This is the emitter terminal, but emitter is not directly connected to ground. Rather, there is a resistance RE through which emitter is connected to ground. So this time, I cannot connect it together. This time, you have a resistance RE through which it is connected to ground. So whatever R1 parallel R2, how to connect it? So it will be something like that. This resistance is R1 parallel R2. And apart from that, you have RS over here. And you have this signal source, VS. This is RS. The output side, you have resistance RC connected between collector to ground. So this voltage is the voltage V0. So once again, the same job you need to perform. You have to find out the expression for the voltage gain, which is nothing but AV equal to V0 by VS. But this time the calculation will be a little bit different one. Now to start with, let us first identify the base current with this signal source VS. So this voltage, which has been developed over here, this voltage is V pi. This voltage is V pi, and this voltage is VS. So obviously these two voltages are not same. So the current that is flowing through this resistance R pi is nothing but the base current, because this is the base terminal. So the current that will flow through this is the base current IB, and here you have the collector current GM times V pi. As you know, last day also we have established the relationship between the pi model and the H parameter model, and there we have seen that this GM V pi and beta times IB, so these two terms are eventually same. So what is beta times IB? This is nothing but the collector current of that particular transistor. So this is the collector current GM V pi or beta times IB, and this is the base current that is flowing through this terminal. So the total current that will enter at this particular node is nothing but the base current IB plus the collector current beta IB or the IC. So what will be the total current that will flow through this emitter resistance RE is nothing but the emitter current, that is IE, or 1 plus beta times IB. So if we want to identify the current terminal, so the current that will flow over here is IB. This current, this is eventually beta times IB. So the total current that will flow is nothing but 1 plus beta times IB. That means the emitter current, 1 plus beta times IB. Okay. So you have to identify the relationship between this IB with VS. So for this, once again, you need to find out the equivalent resistances. Now, if I assume that the voltage at this terminal, if I assume that the voltage at this terminal with respect to ground is Vin, then I have to identify the relationship between Vin and IB. So what is Vin? Vin is the voltage between this terminal and the ground terminal. So that means the voltage at the base with respect to the ground terminal. So I can easily write down the expression for KVL in this base emitter loop. What is the voltage developed over here? This voltage is nothing but V in. So this voltage is divided into two components. One component is the voltage drop across this R pi resistance, and second component is the voltage drop across this RE resistance. So I can write this to be equal to IV times R pi plus 1 plus beta times IB into RD. Now, looking at the base of this transistor, if I look from this terminal itself, what is the voltage developed? What is the available voltage over here with respect to ground? This voltage is nothing but the V in. What is the current that is being drawn by the amplifier itself? The current is nothing but IB. So looking at this terminal, what will be the effective resistance? So the effective resistance Rin, looking at the base, which we may write like Rin B, Rin looking at the base is nothing but the voltage available between these two terminals and the current being drawn. So Vin divided by I. Nothing but R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re. So whenever you have an emitter resistance connected between the emitter terminal and the ground terminal, so the effective input resistance looking at the base of that particular configuration is obtained by R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re, and this particular rule is known as resistance reflection rule. So it is given by R pi plus 1 plus beta times Re. So this is nothing but the resistance looking at this terminal. So now I can modify the circuit to some extent. So we have Vs over here, the signal source. We have Rs over here, the resistance of the signal source. You have this resistance R1 parallel R2 connected between these two terminals, this base and ground. And looking at the base, the effective input resistance provided by the amplifier or provided by the transistor itself is given by Rin base or Rin B. So equivalently, we have a circuit like this now. We have Vs over here. We have Rs over here. Now we have R1 parallel R2, that is fine. This is R1 shunt R2. And apart from that, the effective equivalent resistance of the transistor looking at the base is nothing but R in B. Effective equivalent resistance provided by the transistor itself, that is R in B, which is equal to R pi plus 1 plus beta times R D. So now you see that these two resistances, they are connected in shunt, R in B and R1 parallel R2. So what will be the effective resistance looking at this terminal? So now, if I look at this terminal, just prior to this R1 parallel R2 combination, if I look at this terminal, what will be the effective resistance? Let us assume that this effective resistance is Rin. So this Rin is nothing but Rin base parallel R1 parallel R2. So it is grounded. So now you can easily find out the relationship between Vs and Vin. Because now it has been, this entire circuit has been simplified. You have Vs over here. You have Rs and you have only Rin. And the voltage that is developed across this, this voltage is nothing but the Vin voltage. This voltage is nothing but the Vin voltage. So this is the Vin voltage, which has been developed over here. So now we can write down the expression. So Vin is equal to Vs upon Rs plus Rin multiplied with Rin. Vin is equal to Vs upon Rs plus Rin multiplied with Rin. Now Vin is given by IB times RPi plus 1 plus beta times IB into RE. And from which you have already calculated the input resistance looking at the base. Now, what is our next job? Next, we need to find out the expression for the voltage gain, that is V0 upon Vs. Now, in this particular expression, we have to represent Vs by means of the available signal quantity which are there in this particular equation. So let us go to the next slide and write down the expression. Already we know that V in is given by Vs upon Rs plus Rin multiplied with Rin, and we also know that V naught is equal to minus Gm times V pi times RC. Now you need to find out the relationship between V in and V pi. You need to find out the relationship between V in and V pi. Now you know here this resistance R pi and this resistance R e, the voltage drop across these two resistances are equated to V in. So as a matter of fact, I can write this I B R pi is nothing but the value for V pi. I B R pi is the V pi. And 1 plus beta times IB into RE is also there. So from this expression, I can write like this. V in IB times R pi plus one plus beta times into IB into RE. So the expression for the voltage gain AV is coming like V naught by Vs. So V naught is equal to minus Gm times V pi times RC. So already you know that this Gm times V pi is equal to beta times IB, because in the last day's discussion we have mentioned that this H parameter model and the pi model, they are equivalent, where Gm V pi current source is equivalent to beta times IB. So instead of writing minus Gm V pi RC, I can easily write this to be minus beta times IB times RC divided by Vs. Now in the expression of Vs, you have to represent this Vs in the form of V in. So from this, I can write Vs equal to V in divided by R in into RS plus R in. Now what is V in? V in is equal to IB times R pi plus 1 plus beta times IB into RE. Divided by R in into RS plus R in. So this is the complete expression for Vs in the form of IB R pi plus 1 plus beta times IB into RE divided by R in into RS plus R in. Now, if I put this over here, so you'll find that it's there. So R in will be Rin will be there in the numerator. The denominator you have Rs plus Rin, and you have IB times R pi plus 1 plus beta times IB times RE. So now if IB is getting cancelled, so we have minus outside beta times RC divided by R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE into R in by RS plus R in. So the expression for R in you already know. Already you have calculated in the last slide the expression for R in, which is equal to R in base parallel R1 parallel R2. So let me write down once again the expression for R in. So expression for R in is, so the expression for R in is R in base parallel R1 parallel R2, where R in base is given by R pi plus 1 plus beta times R e. So as you understand that R in base is typically large in the order of few kilo ohms. Similarly, R1 and R2, they are also very large. So with respect to RS, which is nothing but the source resistance, signal source resistance, which is in the order of few hundreds of ohms or tens of ohms. So normally, this R in by RS plus R in, that ratio I can consider to be equated to 1, because RS is normally typically very, very less as compared to R in, as apparent from the expression for R in. So if I consider that this ratio is almost equal to 1, so we are left with minus beta times RC divided by R pi plus 1 plus beta times RE. So this is the complete expression. However, you can also make some approximation over here that this 1 plus beta times RE is normally very, very large with respect to R pi, because R pi and RE, they are almost in the same order, but there is a beta times magnification over here with respect with RE. So as a matter of fact, this 1 plus beta times RE is much, much larger as compared to R pi. So this expression for voltage gain can be approximated to minus beta times RC divided by 1 plus beta times RE, because this 1 plus beta, another approximation that we are making over here is 1 plus beta times RE. This is for to find out this rough calculation, to have some overall idea regarding the voltage gain expression for this particular amplifier. since this is much much larger as compared to R prime. So minus beta times RC by 1 plus beta times RE. So which is further approximated to minus RC by RE, because beta and 1 plus beta, they are close to each other. So finally, if I want to observe the expression for the voltage gain, ultimately we are having the expression in the order of like minus RC by RE. So this is nothing but the ratio of two resistances. So if I just consider the previous example of common emitter configuration, where you have seen that this voltage gain is a strong function of the transistor parameter, because you have seen that last time the expression for the voltage gain was like minus GM times R0 parallel RC. So GM and R0, they are the function of the transistor parameter. Even if I neglect R0, so we cannot get rid of GM. So on the last circuit where the emitter terminal was directly connected to ground, we have seen that the expression for the voltage gain was like minus GM times RC. So it's a function of the transistor internal parameter. So as a matter of fact, if I replace the transistor by a different one, for which the value for this mutual conductance is different. So in that case, or even if the same transistor, but we are operating the transistor at some different temperature, say at winter day or summer day, so the internal parameters will be different to some extent, even for the same transistor. There you see that the voltage gain will be a function of this internal parameter. So as a matter of fact, in summer time, you'll find a particular value of the voltage gain. In winter time, you'll find a different value of the voltage gain, even for the same configuration, for the same transistor. But here, you'll see that this dependence on the internal parameters, dependence on GM, dependence on R0, is completely eliminated with some approximation. And if I want to have some rough approximation regarding the expression for the voltage gain, you will see that this expression is coming like minus RC by RE. So if a circuit is given to you, this kind of circuit is given to you, and if you are asked to find out the approximate value for the voltage gain, even in gate examination, suppose a circuit like this is given with different values of R1, R2, RC, and RE is given, and some internal parameters, I mean GM, R0, these are also provided. And suppose there are four options. So instead of calculating this entire calculations, this expression for the voltage gain, V0 by Vs, even if I just observe the value for RC and RE, and if you know that these are the approximate value for the voltage gain, you can clearly find out the value for the voltage gain just by finding out the ratio between RC and RE. So it will give you some rough approximation, some rough estimation regarding the value of the voltage gain. And obviously, this particular expression will give you another information, that the expression for the voltage gain, this minus RC by RE, since it's a ratio, and normally RC and RE, they are almost close. RC, suppose a few tens of kilo ohms, and RE like 1 or 2 kilo ohms. So this ratio is not very large. So unlike the previous case where we have GM times RC, where GM is GM times RC, that particular product is much much larger as compared to this minus RC by RE, because normally GM, the expression for GM is much much is higher as compared to this 1 by RE, because GM you can easily calculate from ICQ by VT. So this GM is large with respect to this 1 by RE. So as a matter of fact, last time we have got a voltage gain whose magnitude was higher in the value of, I mean, in the order of like GM times RC. This time we have got a voltage gain only minus RC by RE. So as apparent for any particular practical circuit, you will see that this expression for the voltage gain is, the exact value of the voltage gain is less, but this particular circuit is much more stable as compared to the previous one. So now we have two cases. In one case, without any emitter resistance, if I want to summarize, now we have two cases without RE, without emitter resistance, the expression for the voltage gain was like approximated to minus GM times RC. And with RE, when the emitter resistance was present, the expression for the voltage gain was like minus RC by RE. So here, without RE, the AV is higher. AV is higher, but less stable. On the other hand, if I consider the scenario with RE, you'll see that AV is smaller with respect to the previous expression for AV. However, it is more stable. So whenever you will study the feedback amplifiers in some later modules, you'll see that without RE and with RE, the same circuit, voltage divider circuit diagram, without emitter resistance and with emitter resistance, having serious implications regarding the feedback between the output circuit to the input circuit. And accordingly, you can also, you'll be able to justify the importance of the feedback and the association of feedback with the stability of any circuit, right? So so far, since you do not have any fundamental knowledge about the feedback amplifiers, so right now try to understand that with RE, we have a voltage gain which is stable, more stable with respect to any fluctuation, but the value is small. And I'm just telling you for this particular moment, you may not understand, but with emitter resistance, when emitter resistance is present, the circuit provides a kind of feedback between the output and the input circuit. So the voltage gain is reduced to some extent, but it is much more stable. On the other hand, if I consider a situation where the emitter resistance was not there, that means the emitter terminal was directly connected to ground, there you find that the voltage gain is typically very large, but it is less stable. So in which case, there is no feedback between the output and the input. So it is less stable as compared to the with RE case. So I think with this, I may conclude today's discussion regarding this common emitter model of amplifier. And